Let's do this, Jen. Okay. Hello, everyone. Hi. Hi. Thanks for coming. I'm Lee Markopoulos. I'm the chair of CCA's Graduate Program in Curatorial Practice, and I'm just so delighted to be able to introduce tonight's artist, speaker, performer, Genesis P Orridge. And I'm here tonight not only because I'm a fan, but because I'm the organizer of the series in which Genesis is participating. It's called Sound and Vision. It's the graduate lecture series here at CCA. Jen's the sixth speaker, and we're sixth speaker. And we're delighted to welcome her here tonight. And I know that Genesis needs no introduction, but I do want to take a moment to pay tribute to her achievements and the many, many transformative moments in her life and career. And I'm going to start at the beginning. So probably all of you know, Genesis was born Neil Andrew Megson in 1950 in the UK. And in fact, I hope it's okay to say, just celebrated her 65th birthday on Sunday. In those 65 years, she has reinvented and reintroduced herself again and again as a Fluxus pioneer, a groundbreaking performance artist. We were just talking about the fact that before Marina, there was Jen. And also as a wrecker of civilization, the inventor of the term industrial music, and also the inventor of the genre industrial music. Jen's an essayist, a theoretician, and most recently has also been developing her theories around pandrogyny with her partner, Lady J. So in her first incarnation as co-founder of Coombe Transmissions, which was a radical British performance group, she operated from 1969 to 75 and gained notoriety in the UK through subversive infiltration of mass media and the postal systems and the art establishment, and really paved the way for the Sex Pistols and the punk movement. In fact, I think it was something like 8 weeks before the Sex Pistols were castigated by the establishment, Coombe had been termed the wreckers of civilization.
On the same program,
yeah. So, and then right after Coombe, it sort of segued neatly into Throbbing Gristle, the first industrial music band, which distorted and expanded the possibilities of sound from 1976 to 81. And then Throbbing Gristle had a re-emergence of 2004 to 10, which I won't talk about now. After Throbbing Gristle, there was Psychic TV, which pretty seamlessly merged in 1981, which Jen co-founded with Peter Christofferson. That band became known, or is known, for its experimental video and music output across a range of musical genres, and I do want to point out that they're in the Guinness Book of Records for the most records released in 1 year. So we salute you for that. And so now Psychic TV is a reformed as of 2003 as PTV3, and they're just about to embark on a European tour in March in support of the newest LP, Snakes. So we're really lucky that Jen's made time to be with us here today. I did also want to point out another fact I learned today, that Jen is associated with 300 LPs. So if you're collecting, that's the target to go for. She's also a published poet and author with a long-standing interest in the occult, founding member of the Temple of Psychic Youth, which had a critical influence on 1980s culture and popularized tattooing, body piercing, acid house raves, and other cultic flirtations and investigations. So we're talking about here someone who is much, much larger and more important than this small intro can do justice to, but we're just so lucky we can spend some time with her. Thank you, Jen, and thank you all for being here.
Thank you. Wow. Makes me tired thinking about it. If we talk in sort of gasps, it's because we've got a chest infection, which we apologize for. We've been traveling a lot. Luckily, this is just primarily about sound, which makes it easier. Otherwise, how do you do a whole life like that in a couple of hours? So sit down, get comfortable, because you will be here for a little while. Some facts that people never ask about and never get written about relevant. My father was a drummer in a jazz band before the war. He also used to race motorbikes and was reputed to have been the first person to go 100 miles an hour down down Prince's Parkway in Manchester. And at the age of 17, he found out that the British Army had the best motorbikes. So he lied about his age and joined the army and ended up at Dunkirk. Then used to drive through the Blitz to deliver messages in Manchester with the bombs dropping. His motorbikes were blown up more than once. And he taught me to play the drums. I started playing the drums at the age of 3. And he was really into jazz. And so he would play me Duke Ellington and Art Tatum, Count Basie, all the sort of classic pre-war jazz bands, and also take me to the Free Trade Hall in Manchester to see them play live. So my grounding in music from a very early age was jazz. And jazz, of course, is famous for its ongoing relationship with improvising. And improvising is the key to most of the music that we've ever made. Taking something and working with it without any fixed destination and seeing what happens. And also the other key tool that we've used is, of course, the cut-ups. And a lot of you probably know about William Burroughs and Brian Gysin and the cut-ups. But in case you don't, we happen to have a little video which will explain it to you and save me having to speak for a minute.
Is it just going to go through?
I am that I am. I am that am I. Am I that I am? Am I that am? I that I am. Am that I? Am I? That I am. That am I am. That I am I? That I am. That am I? Am I? I that am I? I that am. I am I. Am that? I am. Am I that I am? I am that I am. I am I that am. I am I that. I am that am I. I am I am that. I am. Am that I. Am that I am I. Am that. Am I. Am that I. I am. Am that. I am. Am that. Am I.
And so on.
And so on it goes.
But of course, what he's incredibly famous for is inventing the cut-up.
I had a number of sheets of newspapers, some British newspapers, American newspaper published in Paris, and some other things that happened to be lying on my desk when I took a Stanley blade and cut through them. And these little bits and pieces looked so amusing to me that I started jiggling them around as one would in a collage.
Yep, cut. Tangle, forward line.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Yes. Hello.
Yes. Yes. Hello.
Yes.
Look Hello. At that picture.
The yes. cut-ups I'd been into Good. For a long yes. time and hadn't Thank known, Hello. Those were so commonly credited to Burroughs that it was only after I read Burroughs on it that I realized it was from Brian. So when I met him, I knew who he was.
I said I'm Ira Cohen. Anyway, you don't have to like me if you don't want to. But just don't tell me about it.
That was really a good shot, huh? I created the shot, really. Brian was just sitting there, and I just nosed right into him so she could get a good double profile.
The first time that I met Brian in his room, he was talking about the cut-up, Minutes to Go, which I read at that time. And when I went home, I tried making cut-ups. So I made a few, and I used that technique here and there to somehow get something started when I just felt like writing, but I didn't have anything in mind. And then I start thinking, okay, I'll play the cut-up game. And sometimes it would actually really work.
Throw it out the window, and it'll come in the door. John Latouche to Brian Gysin. For Brian Gysin, the original blue-eyed sailor of the Sahara, welding your ship with rivets of Japanese calligraphy, you tack your sails of smoke and rise like the golden eagles of Fabergé, stolen from the blunted edge of a Tangier fantasy. Searching in a world of reflections, I invoke the spirit.
He's boring. Sorry, but lovely man, but really annoying when he's reading. So anyway, so we'd heard about these cut-ups, reading these books. One of the books was called The Job, and another one was The Third Mind. And all we knew was that they were doing experiments with tape recorders. Well, that was about it. There wasn't really a lot of really clear information. And we'd been listening at that point. We'd discovered this series of records called Avant-Garde. And they had Stockhausen and Ligeti and John Cage, all the modern classical electronic composers. So we were listening to those too. And then we got hold of a book by John Cage, Silence. And we were reading that, and we were just thinking, this is amazing. Everything can be music. Every sound that's happening in the room right now is part of what's being played. Things falling over, doors closing, chairs being scraped, people muttering, dropping things on the floor, cell phones going off, please turn them off. Actually, you can leave them on today. And so we were looking at that. We were just breaking down this idea. What could music be? Does it have to be anything that has skill? And we were lucky. Somebody gave us a couple of old tape recorders. And so we thought, let's try and make music. But none of us play anything. Doesn't matter. John Cage says it doesn't matter. So let's just do it anyway. And we started to record in the loft of the house. We'd also just discovered where we could get hash, so we were also smoking hash up there. It probably helped us to be encouraged to experiment. And there we were, playing with different instruments we found lying around, old maracas, a guitar that had the neck broken so you could bend it and it would make weird noises. Then somebody taught me that you could get a kitchen knife, put it on the edge of the table and hit it and then move it in. It would go brrrr. So we thought, oh, we can make music. And we did. And we used the tape recorders as the amplifiers as well as recording on them. This was 1967. And things were just exploding everywhere. People were just going, everything's possible. And as it happens, we have this urge, we've always had it. If you're going to do it, complete it. Don't just talk about it. Make it and make it available. Well, we didn't get much spending money, so we could always only afford one album. So we looked in a paper, and we found an address, DeRoy Sound. One album for something like £2. And it was basically an acetate, but we didn't know that. It turned out it was the same place that Ian Brady got all of his Hitler Species recorded his albums, so he could memorize them, but we didn't know that either till later. So the same machines that cut Hitler for Ian Brady, the mass murderer of Britain, made this record for us. Somehow we've always felt that those kinds of things leak into what you make, fetishized items. Be warned, it's terrible, by the way. These are just little kids playing. But it's the beginning of the story. God, I haven't even heard this for ages. How do you turn this on anyway? The technician's gone. That's what happens to sound when it's going through a bad tape recorder.
beautiful.
We haven't played this for years, so we don't know what's on there.
You went so far away, I had no words to say. You wrote me out of tune, then left me for the moon. It's such a simple tale, one that will never fail to open wounds inside the soul that will be there till we're all old. I couldn't help the things we did, or even words we said. They came and went like flowers in the beauty of those hours. One day you may recall the beautiful flowers that could have grown so tall. But until then, I'll say a prayer, and I will wait like empty air. It's a case of no one knows, and she who comes always goes.
And so on. So when that was found, we were at living in Brooklyn, and one of my friends, Ryan Martin, who's now my personal manager, was one of the people tasked with cataloging my archives. And he came up one day and he says, "Jen, I found this box with all these tapes in it. What are they?" And we went, "Oh, it's horrible. No, it's just what we did when we were kids." He said, "Well, people might be interested." And we said, "Why would they be interested?" He said, "Because it's what started the process of where you are now." And we thought, yeah, there's a point to that. We're using distortion, we're using voices, and we're using anything that's available at the time. That is basically still the formula. So in fact, even though it was so, as English would say, cack-handed, or infantile, we were 17, 15, 16, we'd already locked on to a process that we would continue to this day to investigate, which is, it's not what skills you have, it's how you think about life and what your attitude is to each other that makes something special. There are millions of people who can play the guitar brilliantly. There are thousands of opera singers, and they do nothing original at all. But then you put somebody like a baby in a room with something that makes a noise, and they'll do something unique. Which has more value? So we very early on realized that the skill, the trained musician, had terrible flaws, had weaknesses, which are that they get used to the way things are supposed to be. How do you break that down? How do you break down habits and routines and expectations? With the tool of the cut-up, you take something, you break it up, and inevitably you get new collisions, new variations, new novelties that you would never get by logical thought. And that's a good way to break down all kinds of habits, even behavior. So that was the beginning. Going and learning about that. Not long after, a friend of mine, Spidey, came to me and said he'd been listening to John Peel and he'd heard this band, The Velvet Underground. And he thought that I would like The Velvet Underground. So I said, okay. We went to Boots in the town we lived in Birmingham, Solihull, and said, "Have you got The Velvet Underground?" And they said, "What's that?" And so we told them it was a band from America, and they eventually ordered it for me. And then it turned out that when I was supposed to be doing my maths exams to try and get into university, that record arrived at Boots. So I got on my scooter, had a Vespa, at lunchtime and thought, I can just make it, get the record, and come back and take my exam. So I got to Boots, I went in, they still had the booths where you could listen in those days, and on came John Cale playing the viola, and I just thought, oh, that's so fucking amazing. I've never heard anything like that before. Venus in furs, sex, violas, deadpan voices. This is fucking great. Forgot about the exam, then suddenly thought, oh shit. Ran down to the scooter and it sprung a leak in the gas tank. It wouldn't go. So I didn't get that pass. I had to take it 3 more times before I passed maths. But it was worth it for the Velvet Underground. That record woke me up, as it has so many people. At the time, we had a girlfriend who played violin in the school orchestra at a girls' school, and she had a spare violin, so we said, Jane, can I have that extra violin? Yes, she said. So I immediately started putting microphones in it and trying to make it distort and just started to mess with it. There's a phrase on the back of that first album, which was called Early Worm, by the way. And it says, we have nothing to say, and we're saying it. So what Ryan did was, he said, people would like to hear these. He started his own record label, Deus Records, just to release this Early Worm. And it sold out in about a week. So he started bringing out more of these old tapes. And now Deus Records is a very renowned boutique label that releases records by all kinds of people. Old records that have been forgotten, new records by people like Youth Code, who are at the moment touring with Skinny Puppy. So not only did that record lead us into making music, but it's also created labels and opportunities for other bands who otherwise might not have a record released. So don't think that just because it's not quite perfect, it can't have an impact, because it can. 30 years later, those games in the loft with the tape recorder created a platform for dozens of musicians to experiment and release their music. We've always felt that you should give back. It's not just about who makes it, it's about opening the doors. If you see a door, you go through it, but you leave your foot in the door so somebody else can come in with you. And that's the kind of technique that we use. That's strategies. Being a cheeky little bugger, I sent a letter to John Peel saying, I have this great band called Coombe Transmissions, and I think you should have us on your show, John. He said, well, I'm DJing in Hull, in Yorkshire, which is where we were living then. He said, so why don't you come and I'll talk to you? So we went to see him, and we'd come up with this stupid idea of Goz rock. Goz was spitting in those days. This is 1970, 71. So when we met him, instead of shaking his hand, we all spat on him. And he was impressed, surprisingly. He wrote about it in the music papers the next week, that he'd met these people. He said, I met these people called Coombe, who are progenitors of Goz rock. And some people might say they are mad, but the world needs more people mad like this. We thought, oh, he likes us. So we sent him a tape. We went to the radio station in Hull and said, John Peel likes us, he wants us to make a demo tape. So they said, oh, great, come on in. So we arranged to go in, and we didn't tell them that we couldn't play anything, that we didn't really have proper instruments. And we went in and started to record. And then we sent those tapes to John. But first, you should probably hear a little bit, so you know why he said what he said.
On screen, red-haired, green-eyed boy, white skin, and pink freckles. Kissing up his neck, girl, and sister. Both of them said that she's going to be back, all the world kisses. So I think it'll low bed covered in that silk. The girl opens his front with gentle fingers and pulls down.
That's basically his naked lunch.
I want you to travel.
We met this guy in Hull, Ray Harvey, beautiful, beautiful black guy who was covered from head to foot in tattoos even then, 1970, and he couldn't read or write, but for some reason he was really taken with our chaos, so he would turn up when we got live gigs and make up songs, and that's his voice. He would have a tambourine, and by the end of a song, it would be smashed into pieces, and it'd just be covered in blood. He died last year, but before he did, we managed to send him a copy of this record, the only one he's on, The Sound of Porridge Bubbling. And this is what John Peel said. Thanks for the tape. Certainly different. Different to most of the things we've heard, but not quite what we're looking for. Interesting, though. Have a good summer. Thanks, John. Poor John. Interestingly, John Peel refused to ever play Psychic TV. Even though we stayed friends and communicated with letters quite often, it turned out that his producer was a born-again Christian and heard that we were into magic and said, no, you're not allowed to play anything by them on this station. So he never did again. He played one track by TG, United. But a good man. So that's how it all started. And if anyone's interested in going into those old days, they're all available on Deus Records to some degree or another. But I think you can already see that there's a sort of a form happening, that it's gone from just pulsing feedback to drums and some kind of guitar and a vocalist. So we're developing this style very slowly. We carried on doing all these different things. Including, we have to play a little bit of this just because it's funny. At that time in the early 70s, we were living in basically a squat. It was called the Ho Ho Fun House. It was two Georgian houses broken together, 19 rooms, of which only three were rooms where it didn't rain into the room when it rained. And it snowed into the kitchen. It was a rough life, but we enjoyed it. And there were, in the kitchen, which was a huge room, we had two pianos that we'd dragged out of the street and rescued. And one of them, we painted it all blue, so that we could play the blues. Yes, there's a lot of English humor in this too. This is what people often miss with everything we've done, is the humorous side. And so we started recording my piano pieces of the blues. But to make it interesting, we also played worn-out tapes of me trying to memorize history homework for my exams earlier. Thank you. you're probably thinking, how the hell did this end up becoming Throbbing Gristle? It's pretty obvious, isn't it? It's not that different. So we carried on doing these kind of jams, literally all the way through the 70s while we were doing Coombe Transmissions, the performance group. And we recorded everything that we did. Dozens and dozens of cassette tapes. Oops. In 1971, we got a magazine, and in it, there was a list of requests. It was called the Image Bank Request List. It was a file magazine. And one of the entries said, William S. Burroughs wants Camouflage for 1984. Bear in mind, this was 71. 84 seemed a long way away. So we thought, it can't really be William Burroughs' address, can it? Surely he wouldn't give his address out. Well, why not write anyway? How do we get his attention? Then we had an idea, so we wrote this letter, typed it out. Dear William, in brackets, and Allen Ginsberg and Gregory Corso and the rest of you, we are sick and tired of you pretending that you know me and using my name to try and appear to be credible and special. So I'm asking you right now to cease and desist immediately from ever mentioning my name again. And it went on like that in its rant. And then it was in the middle of a sentence, you turn it over and it was blank. We sent it off. About a week later, a postcard came through the door and we picked it up and it went, Dear Genesis, that was very interesting. I think, it's going to be like John Peel again. Here we go. But then it went, if you're ever in London, come and see me. Here's my phone number. Just get a taxi and I'll pay. I thought, well, that's better than John fucking Peel, isn't it? So off we went, hitchhiking down to London. We arrived at my friend's place, Robin Klasnick, who had a studio in what became 10 Martello Street, which became the Death Factory. That's how we found a place there from him. And we crashed out in his studio. When we woke up, he gave me coffee. He said, Jen, you've got some weird friends. I was like, yes. And this guy kept ringing up, pretending to be William Burroughs, and saying, can I speak to Genesis? So I told him to fuck off and stop being stupid. I said, that was William. He said, oh no. Oh God, I've always wanted to meet William Burroughs and I just told him to fuck off. So we went to see him. And he was very, very charming and helpful. And he showed me his notebooks. He showed me about cut-ups, magic, all kinds of things. And we said, what about these cut-up experiments with tape recorders? There's never anything in there about, you know, you can't get hold of them. There's readings, but there's none of these experiments. And he did what I did later. He goes, yeah, they're not interesting. Nobody wants to know about that. It took me something like 7 or 8 years to persuade him to let me hear those fucking tapes. But he did. Finally. Actually, it was 1980 when he finally let me listen to them. Because by then we had Industrial Records. So we've skipped a bit, but we'll go back. And we went to visit him in the Bowery in the bunker and said, where's all the tapes? So he brought out all these shoe boxes filled with cassette tapes and reels of tape. Just went, here they are. Oh, shit. So we spent several weeks going through all the tapes and cataloging every single edit, describing each bit of sound, and went through. Then he said, there's more in Lawrence, Kansas. So the next year we went to Lawrence, Kansas. By that time he'd moved, and spent 2 weeks with 8 hours a day with headphones on, myself and Sleazy, Peter Christopherson, just listening to William going, meow, 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 meow. Wow, could do a great imitation of William by the end of that 2 weeks. But it was an eye-opener. And we persuaded him to let us do an album so that everybody could finally hear what the hell they were talking about. And it was called Nothing Here Now But the Recordings. And it has different pieces of raw material from different eras, from the 50s right through. And you'll see that it's not that far removed, in a way, from what we were trying to do. Different. It kind of made us feel better about what we'd done, you know? Okay. It turned out it was the last record we did release on Industrial Records. But it's just been re-released on Deus Records, again, a good label. And so there are still some left if anyone wants to try and get hold of this. It's still the only album of the early cut-up tape recorder experiments. There's a really good bit on it on the other side. He got this letter from England while they were in the Beat Hotel. Side B. It's from one of his lawyers, I think. So he does an actual cut up of the letter in the Beat Hotel. It's one of my favorites. The voices are Brian Guyton Burroughs and Gregory Corso. Let's see what it really says.
Something which you quote Paris during the And Annie, you know, I thank you in it, but carry over and all proper me.
And so at the end he realized it kept saying profitably, and it was about money. It was a legal letter demanding money. So that's the grounding that led to the next phase, all of that. Cum transmissions got pretty notorious in Britain for extremely visceral, transgressive, intimate performances. And then we started getting invited to big arts festivals by the British Council and starting to be recognized as serious art. And to be honest, it kind of unnerved us a bit. We thought, do we really want to end up being darlings of the art world and get nice photos taken that get sold in editions in Italian galleries? Nah, sounds boring. What else could we do? I happened to be in an old pub in Hackney talking to this man who was gassed in the First World War. And he said, I know I understand why you do the weird things you do, because you've explained it to me. But he said, would the people in this pub understand? They wouldn't. I said, yeah, you're right, they wouldn't. He said, so what would they understand? And we came to the conclusion music would be a good way to get their attention and still say something interesting. But how was the question? So we went back to 10 Martello Street, where Robin Klasnick had now got us a space. And the reason it was called the Death Factory was that the plague pits were right outside in London Fields Park. And as it was in the basement, we were at the same level as the plague pit and all the victims of the plague. And we had no equipment, but somebody had left a broken bass guitar. And we'd just met Chris Carter, who was an electronic whiz. He built his own synthesizers. And he fixed up the bass guitar, but he did it wrong. He put in two lead guitar humbucker pickups by mistake. But it sounded great. But we'd already got obsessed with echoes and distortion, so we built our own effects pedals. One of them was called a gristleizer, which was basically something like a harmonizer, but it would also chop up signals into random patterns. And we built all of our own speakers, our own PA, our own monitors, our everything. So now we had a bass guitar and a synth, a modular synth, that's all there was then, homemade. Sleazy wanted to be involved, and he was really into the Burroughs tape recorder experiments. And he traveled a lot doing album covers for people like Pink Floyd. And so he'd been in Japan and got some Walkmans, the first ones. And he took them home and he made what we called the box of tricks, because there were no samplers back in 1975 at all. And he got them and he took them apart and reassembled them so that each one could play both sides of a cassette and each side of the stereo. So each one could have four sound sources. And those could be as long as a cassette, so it could have 90 minutes of four sounds on each cassette. And then he had keys for each of those sounds. And he had eight Walkmans. So he had a lot of sound sources. And he was really into surveillance equipment. So he started bugging offices of mercenaries and gay brothels and all kinds of places that he said had atmosphere. Because we all believed you could actually absorb atmosphere in sound. We still do. And so he basically invented sampling. It was kind of a contemporary idea of the mellotron. But he could also sequence it. So he could create rhythms of completely random sounds. People in the street, cars, bits of TV. Basically, a massive version of the Burroughs album in real time. And then we said, well, there has to be a guitar, because all bands have a rock guitarist. But none of them really have a girl guitarist right now. They didn't in those days. So let's make Cozy the guitarist. And she said, but I can't play. And we said, of course, it doesn't matter. So we bought her the cheapest guitar we could get from Woolworths, a 15-pound satellite guitar. And she put it on, and she said, it's too heavy. So we got an electric saw and just chopped all the extra wood off and gave it back and said, now is it heavy? And that's how she ended up with her special signature guitar. And then we started to play every weekend. We'd all meet Friday and we'd go to the Death Factory and we would jam and we would record it. And we rang up Burroughs and said, what's the best tape recorder for recording things? And he said, it's a TX something or other. So we bought one and put it on a table at the other side of the space and recorded everything we did. Then that we'd do that Friday and Saturday. On Sunday, we'd listen to the tapes and dub across just the bits we liked. And then we'd try and see if we could do it again, if we could repeat what we liked. We did that for a year before we ever played outside. And that became Throbbing Gristle. So on September the 3rd, 1975, my dear friend Monty Kazaza was living with me at the time, who's a Bay Area artist of note and notoriety. And we were walking across the park in Hackney, and we were saying to Monty, we've got the logo, we've got the name. It has to be a ridiculous name, because in the end, people will associate that with the sound instead of its original meaning. And we've got a sound, but we need to call the music something. What could we call it? And my first suggestion was factory music, like Warhol. You know, oh, well, Warhol had the factory and he churned out art, so we could churn out music like him. We could be the factory, but it was a bit obvious. So later on, we gave that to Tony Wilson. One of those little anecdotes that you don't hear often. And then after a while, Monty just said, Jen, you keep using the word industrial all the time. Why don't you just call it that? And I went, what, industrial music? He goes, yeah. You know what, that works. Okay, it's industrial music for industrial people. That works. Because we've been trying to come up with this music that you could play in factories. You know, they have Muzak in factories and have horrible radio stations in factories. And then the machines are all fighting it. So one thing we were thinking was maybe you could make music that enhanced the noises of the factory instead of fighting with it. So it turned all those machines into something that you could enjoy and rhythms and so on. So that was one of the things we were seeking at the beginning. And then we decided, well, there's no point in doing this unless we actually see what happens if we make it public. So we got together and we said, how much money have you got? It was just like the first record again. How much money have we got? And we had just enough to press, I think it was 789 copies of an album. And so we sent off this tape, all recorded on this condenser mic on a cassette recorder, the whole album. No overdubs, no nothing, just jams. And it came back, and that was Second Annual Report by Throbbing Gristle, a record that's never been out of print since. Somewhere in the world, it's always been in print. How weird is that? The right thing at the right time. So you probably have to hear a bit, don't you? Some of you will have. We got it here, this one. I know, I thought it brought it. It's somewhere around. Where's the rest of them? Oh, they're over there.
to crash through your window. And then I opened up your roof very slow. Slug, see it? Can't wait. I'll walk into your bedroom. And I'll look at you with your 7 month pregnant womb. Look, be it. And win. I'll get your husband from the bedroom. I cut his balls off with my knife. I make him eat them in front of his pregnant wife. He teaches his balls off. I look at him very soft. Look, look, see him. On the floor. I want you to say don't do it anymore. Look, please. Cannot wait. I look at your big belly stomach.
Could you do it better? You got nothing to say, the lot of you.
We all say
You're just idiots, you know. You're so bloody ignorant. It's unbelievable. Come on. Anybody can't think you know what they're talking about.
Not everybody liked it straight away. You have to remember that this is parallel to punk, so the Sex Pistols were just learning to play things like Roadrunner and Louie Louie, and we were doing this. That was live, as you can tell. So there was a split. Some of you may have heard of Sniffing Glue, which was the original British punk fanzine run by a friend of ours, Mark Perry. And in it, he had this famous page that was said to have spawned 1,000 punk bands. Learn 3 chords, form a band. So we wrote in and said, why learn any chords? I mean, how can you be revolutionary and you're learning chords already, right? So that was where the spit started straight away. I'm not sure who won. Let's put it this way. There's an awful lot of rhythm and blues that's called punk because it's loud and fast. But it didn't change music. And it boggles my mind to look around and think, this is how many years later, let's see. Gosh, how many years? I'm not good at math, as you know. You've already heard that. What's 75 from 15? What is it? 15? 40 years? Shit. 40 years, and there's industrial music labels across the globe, DJs across the globe, people playing music and calling it industrial across the globe, T-shirts, clubs. As we said to Lee, God, if we only got 10 cents for every time somebody says industrial music, we would be doing good. And it's probably hard for young people. We meet young people, they go, what do you mean you invented industrial music? It's always been there. Yeah, well, in your life, yes. But not once. It is weird. We didn't know that was going to happen. Somebody said to me, how long do you think it'll take to sell those 700 and odd albums? And I said, I don't know, 2 or 3 years. But what happened was we gave a copy to Sandy Robertson, who used to write for this music paper called Sounds. And we gave a copy to John Savage, who wrote for Melody Maker. And for whatever reason, they both loved it and gave it 5-star reviews. So suddenly, a week after we gave them away, we got phone calls off Virgin Megastore. How many copies can we get of that Throbbing Gristle album? Everybody wants to buy one. I don't know, how many do you need? Oh, could we get 2,000? No, sorry. 100? Okay, we'll take 100. And I can remember being so excited to go into the Virgin Megastore, and somebody had scrawled in felt-tip pen, industrial, on one of those little things they put in. And there was just our album. I thought, we did it! Wow! That was a very weird moment. But it was fun, you know. I have to admit, it was fun. But then we started getting tapes sent to us. Cabaret Voltaire in Sheffield sent us tapes. And we thought they were fantastic. And we thought, well, that just shows that what we're doing was inevitable. It's not that we're doing something unique so much as we've picked up on the zeitgeist, you know, on the undercurrent. And we've decided to just do it. Doesn't matter about the skill, again. It's just whatever people contribute becomes the sound. Sleazy puts in tapes, that's part of the sound. Chris wants to put in synth things like Tangerine Dream, it's part of the sound. I play the bass with a leather glove on, part of the sound. And Cozy goes, and it's part of the sound. So how does a new sound begin? It begins from the people. It's the combination of the people. It's picking the right people, and in a way, loving the right people, so that you're not afraid to just do what feels in your heart the thing to say or do. One thing that we did that became popular was deadpan vocals with an English accent. Everybody was still copying America, like the Stones still do. You know, all this rock, there was glam rock was the big thing. And so this was a shock to people. The first review we ever got for a live concert said, and this is a quote, big letters, the headline, "Even an ape with severed arms could play the guitar better than Genesis." We hope so. Another one said, this is my violin that are talking. "We've never seen such utter degradation of a beautiful instrument." Each their own. I think we won the war. So we started sending the records to William and Brian, of course. And much to my lifelong pleasure, Brian Gysin wrote and said, "The only music I listen to when I look into my dream machine, apart from Zhuzhuka, the Moroccan music, is side two of Heathen Earth." That was a hell of a compliment. He'd never played anything but Moroccan music before then. Just so happens we have it right here. And of course, inevitably, you start to develop a certain skill within your own ideas of what sounds good, you know? I listen back now, I can't believe I used to play the bass with notes.
Hi, my name is Naomi. I am 26 years old, and today's date is September 29, 2014. The location.
What was that?
Now you see, we are just a reflection of what's going on all the time, right? There we go.
So we want.
Three. enjoyed this experience of relaxation, and you're feeling energetic. 4. You're about to open your eyes now, feeling refreshed. And 5. Open your eyes now. Take a deep breath, feeling very good and alert.
But that got us thinking, you see. Moroccan music, the Dream Machine, that particular rhythm. What if we could come up with a music that was psychedelic, like Shizuka, trance music, but with modern equipment in a modern context? Because with TG, we were thinking like the Wild Boys, the post-apocalyptic Western world, music that fitted the world we grew up in. You know, for me in Manchester, with all the buildings still crumbling from being blown up, playing in craters from bombs, watching all the steam engines being cut up for scrap, that's where we grew up. So that was the image of modern society that we had. Unemployment, the 3-day week, miners strikes, riots. There wasn't any music for that. So TG was making the music, the soundtrack, for that social event as it happened, in time, in real time. And in a sense, it became much more relevant than just trying to play fast rock and roll. It's lasted because it was relevant, and it speaks. To me, the best music, I see a picture, I see a film. When I'm making up lyrics, I watch a film and describe it. I don't write them down first. So we thought, what can we do? Is it possible to make psychedelic modern music? And we'd already started Psychic TV back in 1981. We got tired of TG and actually finished right here in San Francisco. Just like the Sex Pistols and the Beatles, we split up here. In fact, that's why we picked San Francisco. Sense of history. And so we thought, what about ethnic instruments have some extra quality that maybe is a spiritual, magical quality? What would happen if you work with those? And somewhere around here, there might even be an example. Maybe not. Isn't here? Oh, yeah. Yeah, so we started collecting ethnic instruments, Tibetan thigh bone trumpets, African drums, all kinds of things. Actually, it's not in here, forget that. But anyway, one thing we did was an album we called Themes 1, and one of the tracks was 23 layers of thigh bone trumpets. And another track was actually my first daughter, Caress, crying for milk, recorded holophonically, which is a 3D system, so that you hear sense around sound. And to this day, our second album, Dreams Less Sweet, is still the only album ever made that's totally holophonic. We re-released it recently. We finally found the original master tapes that were with Warner Brothers and re-released it. Will you do your magic for me, please? Oh, we'll hear that girl talking to us again, won't we?
That would be bad.
She's obviously the machine. It doesn't.
to fill them. And in the morning after the night, I fall in love with the light. It is so clear I realize that here at last I have my eyes. Turns and claws rush to spill them. But in the morning after the night, I fall in love with the light. It is so pure I can arise without the fear of secret lies. Na 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 na.
Now, you've got to remember that these are made the same way as the first records you ever heard. We still haven't learned how to even tune anything. We still can't play Three Blind Mice on anything to this day. But we've learned how to collage sound and make things seem to happen. And with this album, we thought, if we're recording in three dimensions, can we also absorb the feeling, the magic of places? So we recorded that first song in a church, and the second sound was in the Hellfire Caves, where the Hellfire Club used to meet. And in another track, we buried the recording device in a coffin in the ground. And then we also recorded some opera-style singing in Caxton Hall, where Aleister Crowley did the Rites of Eleusis. Except that the Latin actually was from Psychopathia Sexualis. And whenever it got to the really dirty bits, Kraft Ebing would switch into Latin. So even though it sounds like this beautiful operatic music, they're actually talking about pedophilia. And there's another nice song, White Nights, that's done just like the Beach Boys, but it's actually just quotes from Jim Jones as everybody was committing suicide. So what is all this sound? Oops. This was Monty Kazaza, my dear friend. We arranged for him to phone the studio at a particular time from the Bay Area, and we gaffer taped the phone onto the recording device so that he just spoke through the phone straight into it and said a poem, but he had no idea what the music was. So the simplest things can be experimental, and sometimes they can seem to have shape and form. Who recognizes this? Charles Manson wrote this song. This is Jim Jones. Sick man.
We win when we go down.
This world is not our home, stepping over to another plane, the next plane, free at last. Santa Claus is checking his list, going over it twice, seeing who is naughty.
And the reason there were machine guns was because anyone who tried to get away was machine gunned. So it's an actual replication of a terrible event, made saccharine sweet to make it more evil. So what we're talking about is music can tell you all these different stories in all these different ways. And you can take any sound from anywhere, and you can use it in an abstract way, or in a melodic way, or in a twisted way, or in a surprising way. But every sound ever recorded, every sound that ever occurs is raw material. And you should never, ever limit what you use. And you shouldn't think you have to sing properly. All the famous singers have terrible voices. Frank Sinatra croons because he can't sing. So does Bing Crosby. Mick Jagger pretends he's from the south of the United States. I do a Manchester accent because it's all I've got, etc. You know, I mean, Captain Beefheart, he does Howling Wolf. You know, so it's the technical voice is actually a crippling thing to have, because then you can't find the soul, the story, the internal dimension that attracts you to a story. And that's always the first thing we say when we listen to music or look at art. What's the story? And the next thing we think about, which we learn from a Shine Apache shaman, is, does this do anything to add to my life? Does this do anything to add to the lives of those around me? And does this do anything for the lives of the people of the world? And if it's not doing something, why the fuck bother? So try and do something with whatever you create. Try and tell stories. Don't be afraid to be intimate. Don't be afraid to reveal things that you're afraid of or that you've been ashamed of at some point. Reveal yourselves, whatever you do, whatever medium. But we're still searching for that psychedelic music. And then we were on tour in America in the late 80s in Detroit, and we were asked to go onto a radio show and have 3 hours to do whatever we wanted. So we used all the cassette recorders and all the turntables and the CD players and the mics, and we played them all at once, three of us, for 3 hours, just mixing everything and anything we could find at random. And suddenly these three black guys turned up and said, "What the fuck are you playing on this, this radio station, man?" And they went, "Well, it's Psychic TV." And they said, "My name's Derek May." And the other one goes, "I'm Derek Carter. We think it's fantastic what you're doing. And we've been doing something like that too. Come with us. So we got in this car with these three guys, and they drove us off into the ghetto. There was a tiny little record shop, and all they had was these white labels, which they said were Acid House. And it was the first ever Acid House records. And I said, I'll have one of each. And we listened to them, we just, that's the answer. That's what we've been looking for. That's the rhythm to make psychedelic dance music. So we brought them all back to England, made a cassette, put them in the car and drove people round. Andy Weatherall, Dave Ball from Soft Cell, and said, listen to this. This is the answer to what we've been looking for. And they agreed, amazingly. So we went into a studio and we thought, if we do this and say it's us, they're going to criticize us because maybe they don't like Soft Cell, or maybe they don't like me, or... So let's pretend it's from the vaults, one of those psychedelic garage records that we found all these weird dance tracks by obscure bands that no one's heard of. And we'll pretend that that's what it is. So we made this album called Jack the Tab. And it got rave reviews in all the papers, and they thought it was real bands from the early 60s. We had so much fun making up the names. We had Pearl Necklace, Rapid Bliss, The Loaded Angels doing Aquarius Rising, Blue Heart by Wolves of the Sun, Oxygen by Griselda, Youth by Vernon Castle, which we found out was a name that, why am I so senile? Tiny Tim was going to be called Vernon Castle. But he rejected it and became Tiny Tim. So that was a little nod to Tiny Tim. There's Only Human by Nobody. Balkan Red Alert by Alligator Shear. And Meet Every Situation Head On by Mesh. Couldn't make enough of them. They were flying out. And it was just collage. Dave Ball had this amazing collection of old, sort of early 60s soul records. And we had just lots of weird records and spoken word records and Teach Yourself Home Birth, everything. And we just started just throwing them in, you know. And this is what developed into the Acid House, you know.
Thank you.
The American love affair with guns. So Dave Ball was looking for something else to put on. And he put on this record and it stuck. So we left it. By then, of course, you didn't need lots of Walkmans. They were actually starting to make samplers, sampling keyboards, strange effects, and so on. So we started playing the studio. And we mixed the albums. We thought, how do we make sure they stay psychedelic? So we both dropped some pure pharmaceutical MDMA, turned off the lights and put on sunglasses and mixed them that way. Seemed like a good idea at the time. You've got to keep playing. That's the other thing we want you to go away with. Keep playing. But also there's stories in there. There's the whole thing about the gun. There's black power. There's Robert Kennedy being shot.
You can pack in the information. And we're going to play this just because...
Something strange happened really quickly with Acid House. It started getting really conservative. We thought of it as just get a good rhythm and then float anything over the top like an electric newspaper. We even had a series of CDs we did called the Electric Newspaper. But very quickly, DJs became superstars and started deciding on formulas and names for the formulas, drum and bass and so on. And then it became big business, the raves. And they were no longer secret parties, no longer drug-addled people, naked, jumping up and down, drinking hot water. Because it was never cold. I don't know if anyone noticed that. Then we came across a song by Queen, with Freddie Mercury, and we managed to sample out on E. So we called it Be On E.
Good old Freddie. Hope it's the right speed. It might be 45, I'm not sure. Speed on this or not? Can it go 45 or not?
Yeah, we have to take the platter up.
We have to do what?
We have to take the platter up and switch them around.
Oh, you do? Yeah. Otherwise, you won't hear Freddy. He'll be going, Oddy! Instead of,
Oddy!
Is it on 45 now?
It should be.
You're so clever. That's better.
And then we got really bored with music and stopped doing it all together. From around 91 to sometime in the mid to late 90s, right, Janice? Yeah. We had other things to do, like being exiled from Great Britain and moving here and surviving and so on. And then we got asked to do Psychic TV again in 2003, which Lee mentioned. But we want to run along a bit because we want to try and see if we can have questions too. But strangely, we still use exactly the same technique as we used in that little cubbyhole in the attic of the house. All of it is just collaged together. It's all done with feel. It's all done with instinct and intuition and humor, or to say something political. But that's what we want you to take away, that you can build all kinds of different structures, from obvious songs down to the most abstract thing, using the same techniques, cut-ups. Cut them up, put them back together, and as William says, see what it really says. So we're going to switch a little bit, just for those of you who know about popular music. When we moved to New York, we got to know some people who are this band, the Yeah Yeah Yeahs. You may have heard of them, I don't know. Has anybody heard of the Yeah Yeah Yeahs? Good. That's good. So they had this song, Y Control, I think it was off their first album. And they asked us if we do a remix. So we said yes, of course. So this is the original. So they gave us the masters for this, and when we started to play them back, we discovered that she was banging her foot on the floor to the rhythm the whole way through the fucking track. And when they recorded it, they left the microphones open, so every track had everybody else in it. It was a nightmare. And he's like, what the hell do you do? Take the foot stamping as the beat. So we triggered a drum with her foot stamping because it was louder than the drums. And then we sampled little bits of guitar where it wasn't covered by something else, and we rebuilt it. And then Karen said, where's all my vocals? We said, they're right at the end. Much to our surprise, last year we got contacted by Trent Reznor. Out of the blue, got this email. Hi, Jen. It's Trent. Hi, Trent. How are you? I got this new album and I'd like you to remix this one track. We said, yeah, sure. Now, the weird thing about this was that in Los Angeles in 95, we were staying in one of Harry Houdini's old mansion on Laurel Canyon with Love and Rockets, helping them to begin producing an album, and the house set on fire. We ended up falling out of a window, escaping, ended up in a hospital. Rick Rubin, who owned the place and it was employing me, said, oh, don't worry, we'll pay the hospital bill. But that didn't happen. So in the end, there was a court case to get the hospital bill paid. And we won. It went to the Supreme Civil Court of California. And we're not allowed to talk about the court case. We had to have an agreement. But afterwards, we got this really nice letter from this woman, Diane Kosky. She says, dear Genesis and Lady J, you don't know who I am, but I was on the jury in the court case. And we all felt like we really got to know you, and we really liked you both. And how's the pet ferret? And then she said, I work at the LA Zoo, and I take care of the howler monkeys. So I made a cassette tape of the howler monkeys for you, because maybe one day you can use it for something. Yes, Trent. You never know when something's going to come in useful.
So you should play the first one first.
It's actually a really nice song. We got lucky. Oh, I didn't mean that the way it came out. I mean, it was a really nice song of many nice songs. You know, it's one of the many nice songs. This one was a very nice one.
Days I've ever known.
Exactly the same techniques as in that first record. Isn't it weird? Haven't learned anything. So, we're nearly over because we don't want to keep you too long, and we maybe can have some Q&A if people are interested. But before we do that, I just want to play you one track off the new album, Snakes. The reason being, it's another variation of the same thing. Wasn't it interesting how the Howler Monkeys were dead on rhythm? When we put it on, the engineer in the studio went, "How did you know?" I said, "I don't know. My brain's mutated." In a way, because we once said to Burroughs, "Do you still do cut-ups?" And he says, "No, not really." He said, "My brain just does them automatically." And I think my brain does that with sound automatically now, because we just had this weird feeling. Howler Monkeys, that rhythm, they'll go together after about 20 years. So, because we like keeping it difficult, now with Psychic TV 3, we never rehearse, maybe once or twice a year. For example, at the moment we're going to do two rehearsals because we just lost our keyboard player and drummer, and we're going on tour in 2 weeks. So we're doing two rehearsals. Keep it fresh. And the new album was done in 2 nights, and we had no songs written. We went into the studio and did it 60s style. So the band, the musicians in the band, who can play properly, by the way, this is the only difference these days. However, we push them as hard as we can. So they went in one room, and then we all said, what are we going to do? And Alice went, well, I came up with this bass line 7 years ago, and I was keeping it for one of my songs, but I've never used it. What do you think? And she played it, and we went, yeah, we could sing to that. So she started playing the bass. The rest of the band just joined in. We went into the little vocal booth and made up a song. And what you hear is one take without overdubs and no rehearsals, all made up, including the lyrics, on the spot. You can mutate.
Even we were shocked. Coming out here and just choose the right side. There it is. Thank you.
And guess what? We like that song too. We still sit, how the fuck did we do that? Amazing. That's 40 years of improvising. It's incredible what can happen. Some people are probably wondering, what happened to Throbbing Gristle? They're in here. Has anybody heard of these gristleisms? Some people have. Let's see if it works today. Yeah, which way round is that? There you go, full circle. Thank you for listening.